Hello and welcome everyone. My name is Kanika Anand and I'm the Associate Curator here at Contemporary Calgary. I'd like to begin by honoring and acknowledging that we live, work, and play on the traditional territories of the Blackfoot Confederacy, comprised of the Siksika, the Kainai, the Piikani, the Tsuut'ina, the Stoney Nakoda Nations, the Métis Nation Region 3, and all the people who make their homes here in Treaty 7. We also acknowledge our immediate proximity to the Bow River, a site that resonates with us all today and with Indigenous populations for thousands of years. Thank you all for joining us on the webinar and also on Facebook Live for what I assure you will be a very engaging conversation between artist Daniela Ortiz and curator Florencia Porta Carrero. I'm going to introduce our speakers and then of course they will take it away from there. Born in Cusco, Peru, Daniela Ortiz's work aims to generate visual narratives in which the concepts of nationality, racialization, social class, and gender are explored in order to critically understand structures of colonial, patriarchal, and capitalist power. Her recent projects and research deal with European migratory control system, its links to colonialism, and the legal structure created by European institutions in order to inflict violence towards racialized and migrant communities. Daniela lives and works in Barcelona and is joining us from Rome, currently where she's in residence. From Lima, Peru, Florencia Porta Carrero writes, lectures, teaches, and organizes both exhibitions and public programs. Her research interests are focused on how to rewrite art history from a feminist perspective, regimes of subjectivation in the context of neoliberal globalization, and the questioning of hegemonic forms of knowledge. In 2017-18, Porta Carrero received the Curating Connection Scholarship awarded by DAAD, Artists in Berlin Program, and the KfW Stiftung. In Lima, she worked as a public program curator at Proyecto Emil from 2015 to 2019 and is co-founder of Bisagra. In today's program, Daniela and Florencia discuss the complicated relationships between structures of colonial, patriarchal, and capitalist power and the fraught emotional responses that these generate. Within this framework, they explore the various ways in which art practices and the everyday intersect. Before we delve into that conversation, I will encourage our audience to share questions, comments in the Q&A feature on Zoom and the comment section on Facebook Live. Throughout the duration of the talk, we do have a dedicated Q&A session at the end of the presentation as well. So welcome everyone, and welcome Daniela and Florencia.
Hi Kanika, thanks a lot for the space.
Hello everybody, thanks Kanika for the introduction. With Daniela, we thought that it would be nice if I could introduce a little bit the talk and our collaboration in the context of Notes for Tomorrow. And afterwards, we will delve on a really recent series in which Daniela is working currently. But well, I'm really excited to be here. I want to thank the ICI team for inviting me to participate on Notes for Tomorrow. And of course, the Calgary Contemporary team for making this conversation between Daniela and me possible. I think it's important to start from the beginning. When Renaud Proge invited me to collaborate on Notes for Tomorrow, he asked me to react to a kind of a straightforward question, but at the same time, a complicated one. Basically, selecting an artist or an artwork that it felt important to be viewed now, or in other words, that could speak to the present moment. It was June 2020. I was pregnant at the moment and experiencing in Lima one of the most rigid quarantines in Latin America. In this context, one of the situations that impressed me the most was how, as a result of the murder of George Floyd, the US Black Lives Matter protest ended up generating a global citizen mobilization, which despite of the COVID-19 took the streets and had as one of its main symbolic actions, the overthrow or vandalization of colonial monuments. This situation immediately made me think about some of Daniela's videos work in Barcelona, city in which she was based until last year, I think, right, Daniela? Mm-hmm. Indeed, between 2012 and 2019, Daniela carried out a series of actions on October 12th, the date of the so-called Discovery of America, in which Spain celebrates its National Day, in order to problematize the reproduction of racist narratives in the public space. She has several actions regarding the Columbus Monument in Barcelona, but also revealed the imperial and colonial substrate of Spanish national identity, and at the same time promote counter narratives that make visible the silent experience of the colonized communities. I thought that in the context of Notes for Tomorrow, this group of interventions that Daniela recorded to share on her social media, which are a platform from which she has consistently given space to forms of anti-colonial dissent beyond the art world, could expand a little bit the map of the anti-racist movement and include some reflections about the particularities of the Latin American experience. And thus, in conversation with Daniela for the exhibition, we decide to show three actions she carried out in Barcelona. I want to make a little bit like the link between the discussion today and what is being shown in the exhibition. So I will like describe like super briefly each one of these actions. CP12 or CP12 consists on a detailed visual traveling that stresses the racist ideology epitomized by the Columbus Monument located in Plaza Colón in Barcelona. It's a very impressive video, and it also shows how this like huge monument also commemorates two Catalan characters who actively participated in the colonial process, the priest Bernardo de Boil and the soldier Pérez de Margarit, who are represented next to an indigenous man kneeling in sign of submission. The other work, the other video intervention is Replica, that take us to Catalunya, to Plaza Catalunya, sorry, one of the main public spaces in which the National Spanish Day is celebrated in Barcelona. Carrying a photograph of the anonymous indigenous man kneeling under the priest Bernardo de Boy, Ortiz, or Daniela, sorry, kneels in front of the passerby, trying to explain them the racism reified by the Columbus Monument. Finally, in Reparación, Daniela reads fragments of El Primer Nueva Crónica Buen Gobierno, a manuscript written by the indigenous chronicler Guaman Poma de Ayala that denounces the abuses committed by the Spaniards during the colony. Then Daniela explains the process of adoption of the original document, which is currently in the Royal Library of Denmark, to finally announce that the facsimile that is shown in front of the camera in the video was removed from the University of Barcelona Library to be handed over to a cultural space managed by migrants and racialized people precisely on October 12th. Since her early works, Daniela has investigated all the process and institutions on which the system of discrimination, exclusion, persecution, and criminalization of racialized people is based. She has meticulously and fiercely scrutinize how the ideology of white supremacy is transferred to very different realms of our life in common. The public space, the migratory system, and lately she has been working specifically around the reproductive and family rights of racialized communities, and even in the art and the culture. Moreover, some years ago, Daniela has embraced what from a Latin American perspective, we could call popular aesthetics, developing projects that materialize using ceramic, collage, textiles, and even formats such as children's books that move away from the aesthetics of the Eurocentric, modern, and conceptual art. For today's talk, Daniela and I thought it would be interesting to discuss a group of works that would give an insight on her latest production. Therefore, in what follows, we will discuss some of the images of the Revealing of the Roots, an ongoing series of paintings that currently has around 60 images, and Daniela told me it will continue and continue growing. The paintings work as Catholic ex voto, that is, small paintings that simultaneously narrate and thank a miracle to a saint or a virgin. However, in this case, the paintings tell the story of tropical plants that kidnapped in botanical gardens in Europe are taken care of by the spirits of racialized people who died in the hands of European racism. In the materialization of what Daniela has named as an anti-colonial fantasy, these plants find their own way to confront and make justice in regard to those politicians responsible of institutional racism. In this way, the work distances itself from the secularism that characterizes the Eurocentric progressist discourses, connecting with various anti-colonial resistance movements and at the same time with the spirituality from the Global South. Well, having given this brief introduction about Daniela's work, maybe we could start looking at and discussing your work, Daniela.
Gracias, Florencia. Thanks a lot. And thanks to Easy and Calgary Contemporary and to everybody involved in organizing this space and also the exhibition. And yeah, like both, let's say, like, let's say the actions you mentioned at the beginning, they for sure have a completely different aesthetic from the late paintings that I have been doing also. But I think also for me, in a way, there is all this critique to this type of white cube performatic aesthetics that are like that have been like strongly embraced by European institutions or American North American institutions, etc. But at the same time, I think like those actions were done also in a moment where I precisely because of the of the economical situation, I found myself in the context of Barcelona. I just migrated to Barcelona with all this Eurocentric idea of studying art there and all this. But what I found was the institutional racism through the immigration law, which was strongly conditioning my life and my economy, because basically by law, I couldn't work legally more than 24 hours. That is something that they put to students. And then also confronting myself with the structural racism in regard to the access of work, no? Like Latin Americans have a specific jobs that we can access. And even like me and myself as a mestizo coming from Latin America, speaking Spanish, I was quite privileged to be able to be a waitress, for example, no? That was a job that you were allowed. And at that time for me, it was really useful, that type of performatic, more, let's say, conceptual art, because it was cheap, it didn't need money, and like I could resolve like quite fast. And for me also was really important to be able to use things from the enemy, no? Like for example, because it was like almost 10 years that I made each 12th of October an action in regard to the celebration and the reivindication of this the 12th of October as a national day, which is one of the many elements that Spain has for building its national identity, because you can find that in the coat of arms, you can find that in their passport, you can find that in all the monuments, the name of the streets, etc. No, there is this type of strong position that has been defended in different governments. Also, you can see that in Franco times it was happening, but then in democracy and then with the left wing on government, they are still reivindicating the 12th of October as National Day. No, so at the same time, it was really useful for me to be able to, let's say, grab that day No, and to even there was an action that is not included in the videos are shown, but for example, that what we did was to steal a flower arrangement that was left at the bottom of the Columbus Monument during the 12th of October by obviously a fascist racist group. And what we did was to steal it and take it to the door of the immigrant detention center, no? Because in that moment, and not only for me, for many other people that we were making a critique in regard to the presence of colonial monuments, is not only because they are, let's say, offensive to our people, to our identities or whatever. It's because they have a reason of being there. They have a reason that has to do with maintaining and sustaining racist narratives that allowed institutional racism to have a migratory control system that persecutes, detains, deports, and murders people in border areas, or an economical system that exploits the territories and the people in the global south. And that's why it is so important for Europe and for the states and for white supremacy in general, we have it also in the context of Lima, for example, no, to maintain those type of symbols, because it's one of the areas in which they want to control the narrative in order to have this type of racist reivindications, no? I don't know if you want me to start sharing maybe like some images of the Rebellion of the Roots, which is this series that I have been working recently, and it's I have been able to go back to painting. That is what I studied, but I couldn't paint almost for like I don't know 8 years or 10 years or some kind of stuff like that. But even though aesthetically these paintings are really different from the actions you were mentioning before, that also were done always without budget, without an invitation. It was always like a self-made action. And also, as you mentioned, for me it was really important because obviously at that moment I didn't have the institutional platforms that sometimes I have right nowadays, no? And for me, what I was doing was sharing it through media, through like Facebook, Twitter, or sharing it through email, etc., no? To like, to do not also depend, no, on the invitation of institutions in order to do art, because I think it's really important to make the difference between making art and making exhibitions, no? And in a way that type of actions allowed me that they didn't cost that much money, they didn't imply that much preparation in the sense of a big budget and many days of working on them. And it was more about thinking how I could create an anti-colonial narrative creatively, allow me to do artistic work without having the supposed conditions that you should have to make artistic work, no? But in this case also, for me, it's interesting to think that even though the aesthetics are different, the series is deeply related to those actions, because, for example, the Columbus Monument was built during the exhibition of 1888 in Barcelona, that it was this type of universal exhibitions that were carried out in all the European capitals and big cities in order to show themselves. Like, for example, the Eiffel Tower was built in the exhibition of 1889, the Atomium in Brussels was built in the exhibition of 1958, and this type of exhibitions was a tool for them to build their identity as a civilization, as in that moment as industrialization. Then with the Atomium we have more like science, you know, and that type of post-Fordist economy in Europe, and then to show themselves as a developed context, etc. But at that same time, when they were carrying out on these exhibitions and building that self-image of civilization, they were also showing racialized people that have been kidnapped in many cases from the global south in what many people call human zoos, which I consider is a terminology that maybe we should question, because many times this narrative build the idea that the exhibition of racialized people forcibly kidnapped from the global south in Europe and the States was part of circuses and freak shows and this type of, let's say, kind of like mistakes in popular culture. And it was not like that. It was part of the most important cultural apparatus at the moment that were universal, international, and colonial exhibitions that were carried out and organized by the governments, not only by business people, no? Many of these exhibitions of racialized people from the Global South also happened together with the creation of botanical gardens and greenhouses that were where they were plants that were kidnapped also from the Global South were being shown. And then also zoos that started appearing in the Global North at that moment, no? And besides being obviously a way of entertaining for Europeans, you know, in their ways of entertaining that until now are quite complex. At the same time, there were like a huge machine for reinforcing racist narratives in regard to the savage, in regard to nature itself, no? And those type of narratives are active until now, no? Like to see nature, whether as this thing that has to be controlled by the man, or this humble thing that has to be protected, that really works in the same way as racism works, you know? Racialized people are these people that have to be criminalized or paternalized on another side, no? And I think in nature it works as a... So basically the series is composed by, as you said, like 60 paintings at the moment, but it's going to be longer, but then it's composed by a small series of three paintings that tell a story in which, for example, in this one, and it relates some. So you get an idea of how it goes. It says, the spirits of those Philippines exhibited in El Retiro Park will give, El Retiro Park was it's a park in Madrid where Philippine people were exhibited in 1887. And it was an exhibition about one of the colonies of Spain, no? And it says, the spirits of those Philippines exhibited in the Retiro Park will give through water their anti-colonial force to the Yalang-Yalang tree, which is a typical tree from Philippines that has a really good smell, inside the Crystal Palace of Madrid. There was this Crystal Palace where people were being exhibited, you know? And then the second image shows the figures of the tree making exploit the palace, saying the strong Yalang Yalang tree will rapidly grow to break the crystals of the palace where the exhibition of colonial violence took place in 1887. And then the last image is a rain of glory crystals will come from heaven during a sunny 12th of October while they are celebrating the 12th of October as National Day to banish those who celebrate the colonial empire. And then there is always a final image in which there is a celebration and a thankful attitude towards the spirit that managed to impulse this type of anti-colonial rebellion, no? But also this story is not this type of stories that I am building. And as you said, Florencia, to quote Imaina Cáceres, that was the person that I read from the notion of anti-colonial fantasies, it's not so fantastic, because in one of the German businessmen that was more involved in kidnapping and exhibiting people in Europe, that was Karl Hagenbeck, and he has a huge zoo until now in Hamburg that is open. He has streets, monuments, etc. And here is where the story comes from, the idea of making this series. He was beaten by a boomslang snake that he kidnapped from the African context in order to show it in the context of Europe, no? And then he ended up dying because of that. I mean, this man that was that reinforcing all this racist cultural structure. And then also he was making so much money out of this exhibition of people, end up dying because an African snake bit him, and he died because of the poison, no? Which also shows up the strength that nature has, that many times anthropocentrism, Eurocentrism, etc., want to take away that strength for nature, no? And then I can show you more images. But for example, Francesc Darder, that was a similar, a type of Karl Hagenbeck, but from Catalonia, also ended up dying, being bitten by a Boomsland snake, which I found is beautiful, no? And then also there is this celebration of the snake. I don't know if you want me to like continue or if you want to like add something, Florence. I can, you know, I can continue speaking and telling stories.
No, I think it's quite interesting the way in which, you know, like you are relating the actions that are part of the exhibition, you know, and these drawings, you know, even though they look very differently aesthetically, you know, how they are completely or deeply connected, as you were saying, you know, content-wise. And I think we should go on, okay, on this line, right? Yeah. Probably just mentioning the idea of this anti-colonial fantasy, you know, and also like the way that you are giving like a stage or importance to the people who have been murdered by like the racist structures, European racist structures, which normally, and this is something we discussed during our conversations, you know, are portrayed as victims.
Yeah.
And as nature, as you were saying, nature is stripping out of its strength, you know, the same with these people that were victims of this racism, you know, and in some way, I think this series is also like giving them back agency as well, and turning them in these kind of anti-colonial heroes, you know, at the same time, you know. So I think this is a very interesting strategy that runs through the series.
And really, and then also, as I will show in this short series, it's a reality. Like there has been 500 years of oppression, but there has been also 500 years of resistance. That's why not only the racialized people from the global south exist. Now I'm working in a series of embroideries that have to do with celebrating the life of those babies from communities that have lived the violence of eugenics and, for example, forced sterilizations like happened in Peru. There was an attempt of white supremacy and the patriarchal colonial capitalist system to suppress the possibility of those communities to grow and to exist. But even though they inflicted all that violence, even though they systematized that, they had resources, they did all what they did, for example, in the context of Peru, in a context of dictatorship with Fujimori, with the USAID on the back, paying all that process, etc. Even though that happened, babies keep on being born because there was resistance against that, those policies, no? And I think also it's really important to celebrate those resistances, because precisely when we think about racism in terms of paternalism, for that it's really useful to only portray as victims, no? When there is no victims, there has been resistance, like, for example, in this this series that I will read it, and it's in the context of Paris and these colonial exhibitions, and it says, in the silent nights of the colonial exhibition, the whisper of a captive Guinean man is heard telling resistance stories of his own town to a lonely Endama cow. And then the image on the right, it's a photo that actually exists from the archives of those exhibitions, no? And the second image says, from the sadness of captivity and confinement, both the man and the lonely cow died. The white man decided to have the leather sold out, arriving to the hands of a Palestinian good man. The leather was transformed into a beautiful shoe. And for example, for me also was important here to include symbols as the Palestinian symbol of anti-colonial resistance, or the to make like a poster of the PIR, that is the Partido of Indigenous of the Republic, that is a group of anti-colonial people that live in Paris that have been being organized. And then the last image says,
The beautiful shoe one day was bought. The new owner name was one we won't forget. Mustasser al-Sahidi got this pair of Andama shoes that were fully made out of leather with anti-colonial sole. The shoe one day flew with dignity and honor to go straight to the head of the beast with sulfur smell, as Chavez called Bush, you know, the azufre, que huele azufre. The empire will be defeated with good leather shoes that will fall to knock the colonial demon. No, and for me also it's important to include like real resistances that have happened, no, like this one. And then the last image says, glorious Guinean man with his lonely in the Macau. We will never let you down. The fight will go on until the empire will tear down. And then this is also in regard to the Jardín de Aclimatación. And this other story also makes a link to contemporary institutional racism that also for me is really important to name it with who, which companies, which politicians, which people, etc. And here it says fire to the colonialism of the Jardín de Aclimatación, that was this place where racialized people were being exhibited while they were exhibiting the Eiffel Tower, that is such a big symbol of France and Paris. And then it says, the tears of the Mapuche, Sedman, Sons, and Zulu people kidnapped from the global south to be forcibly humiliated, exploited, and exhibited and as exotic creatures will water and give strength to the beautiful seed for growing into an anti-colonial potato that will be harvested, washed, peeled, and cooked for Fabrice Legeri, who is the actual director of Frontex, the Migratory Control Agency of Europe, and he's one of the biggest political responsibles of the murder of people in the European Union in the last, he has been in charge for the last 5 years, but it's a system that has been working for 30 years. And actually, Fabrice Legeri appears in like various of my works because it's also amazing to see like people with such political responsibility in regard to this violence have such invisibility. It's really frustrating when there are these type of debates, mostly in the white left wing or white feminist context, where they say, racialized people are invisible, migrant people are invisible. No, that's not true. Migrant and racialized people are all the time in the media, and there is a whole system from the states in the context of Europe and the state to persecute and to deport those people and to incarcerate those people. And it's not a thing about invisibility, it's a thing about persecution that is completely different. The invisibility is something that is granted to those responsibles, political responsibles, those people who have taken political decisions to keep people in the border of Europe, because what is happening that we are talking of more than 60,000 people being dead in the last 20 years in that context is not a mistake, it's a political decision and there is an outcome, no? And also this whole migratory control system in the States, in Canada, in the context of Europe, is not, or in Australia, it's not a casualty, no? It's a continuation of colonialism and the creation of the reproduction of the violence that is lived in the global south inside the borders of those territories that are taken and also many times even stolen by white people, no? So basically at the end, Fabrice Legeri chokes with a potato and he ends up, going away for giving some peace to migrant and racialized people in Europe. And then there is again the celebration of the potato. This other story is about Semiradamu, that is a woman from Congo that was murdered during her deportations. The policeman that murdered her got never into any type of trouble. They were never detained or nothing. And she nurtures the palm tree that there is kidnapped in the Laeken greenhouse. That actually, when you visit that greenhouse in Brussels, during the tour, they told you proudly that palm tree was brought by Leopold II, no, in the time of Leopold II. And then this palm tree creates these strong coconuts that end up falling in the head or over the head of the Ministry of Interior that was responsible for the murder of Semiradamu. And then again, there is a celebration of the coconut and its beautiful smell. And then this other story has to do, and here also, like as you mentioned, something that I am working, maybe in this project is mentioned, But I have been doing several works in regard to the specific violence towards migrant and racialized and mothers and families from the South through not only detention, deportation, exploitation, killing in borders, but also through specific ways, policies that are supposedly designed to protect children and families end up not by mistake, because there is a decision again, creating a situation of violence towards them, no? And well, now I will tell some stories in regard to that. This is, for example, also an image of a group of Congolese women that nurture and eat an entundulo fruit that is nurtured by the corpse of Patrice Lumumba, who was murdered by the Belgians and the US, and then how their children that end up growing up in Brussels because of the processes of colonial migration, that is like a type of forced migration, end up having, like, they are really strong, so they are able to tear down the Leopold II monument in the context, well, the main Leopold of the second monument in the context of Brussels, no? And there is also a celebration of this. And then, for example, I like to put details like in the newspaper where they say that the Leopold falls. On the back part, it says 127 bis, that is 127 bis, detention center burns. That is the immigrant detention center of Brussels, no? And then this also, I made it before all the situation in Canada, in Afghanistan started to be shown again, because the situation of violence in Afghanistan of colonial violence has been happening for a long time. And in this one, also, I missed one image, but well, in this image, in this series also, it has to do with the morphine that is produced from poppy plants that are produced in Afghanistan, and that heroin and the business in regard to heroin has been a big issue in regard to Afghanistan that is never discussed, no? And how this morphine ends up killing, it's too strong, and it ends up killing a French soldier that was also involved in a colonial war in the context of Mali. And then here, this one I'm going to read it because it has to do more specifically with policies in regard to minors and families, and it says, "From far away will come the Alondra Saharan bird that will leave her own town after the climate change. Bringing a tall hat seed, she will cross the big sea, arriving to land in Catalonia," well, it's not Spain, but well, in Catalonia, "and she that she will make fall her lovely seed in the garden of a center for retaining migrant kids. Minors who were separated from their grandmas and moms in the terrible abuse of using racist excuse to take away custodies and love," which is a common practice that is going on in the context of Europe. Like children are being removed from their houses because not because they are living sexual, psychological, or physical abuse, but they are being removed because the social services consider their mothers, because they are single mothers, or they don't have papers, or they ask for help in the social services, are not, let's say, are not able to take care of their children. And there is a whole systematic way of taking children away from the families, no? And then it says, "In the garden of the center, a big talha tree will grow up, strong and forceful, like the Sahrawi struggle." Because the talha tree is a sacred tree for Sahrawi people. "The Sahrawi struggle, it will surpass the height of the wall that keep migrant children isolated from their families and moms. Through the branches, they will escape to run and liberate from the worst colonial pain. Fire will be set on the institutions that impose for migrant children to be not with their, with their grandmas and moms. The Gaia, which is the institution in charge of this in Catalonia, will be burned down after those who escape from the center initiate an anti-colonial revolt. in the garden. And well, with this, I would like to maybe finish in showing these images that has to do with Canada. And I consider it was interesting to share it with you here. And it says, in the garden of Canadian residential schools, coffee plants are nourished by the remains of those children murdered by the white elves. Nuns, priests, and bishops will be eternally awake in the perpetual unrest by the anti-colonial strength of this glorious coffee. Glory and honor to the spirit of Inuit, Métis, and Coweses children that will bring eternal joy to the people and unceasing misery to the colonial oppressor who will be despised by God.
I don't know if we should give time for questions from the public or should we like continue the conversation between Daniel and I. I could start with some questions if it's okay. I don't know what Kanika or Kate think.
Hi. We welcome questions in our Q&A if anyone has them. But I think Florencia, Daniela, you can continue and we can address those questions as and when they come in.
Okay.
Thanks.
I just wanted to say, Daniela, that is super beautiful the way the series celebrates, you know, like the anti-colonial spirit, you know, and how words as glory, honor are constantly used throughout the series, you know, as a way, I think, to give back honor to like the migrant communities that, as you were saying, are super visible, you know, in the media, but at the same time, in a way in which they are taken out their honor, you know, they are anonymous people who represent a kind of a mass, you know. While you were talking about like the privilege of invisibility from like the European, from the European politicians that are related to this institutional racism, you know, who are responsible in some way of these laws that affect the life of so many people, you know. So like this, let's say, combination of strategies that are part of the series, I think that are like super powerful and at the same time, like really beautiful, you know, and playful. Maybe you could expand a little bit. I was reading, Daniela like recently wrote a very interesting essay that in Spanish reads like El interés superior del menor y las políticas de seguridad sobre la infancia como mecanismo de racismo institucional, which roughly translates, I'm going to try to do it, like the superior interest of the infant and the security police over infancy as a mechanism of institutional racism. So maybe you could expand a little bit on your investigation, because it's also like related to like a big kind of line in your work. So maybe we could discuss a little bit that. And I don't know if it's also a good moment to show that image of Fernandito Tupac Amaru.
The whole, let's say, I knew about specific violence inflicted towards migrant minors, mothers, pregnant women, and families, and to reproductive rights in general. Also, let's say historically, no, it's since 1492, like Spanish people were abusing, killing, and also stealing, exploiting children's, etc. No, and I think there is and that's important to see with the contemporary institutional racism, for example, through the migratory control system and the legal system of immigration laws in the context of Europe, there is this type of continuation. No, for me, when I started living in Spain, was really shocking because I had to confront it and go through the immigration office to see that this violence and this type of institutional racism was not a mistake. It was not that the system was not working properly. It was a system created for you to do not have papers in order to be able to exploit you, deport you, and do whatever they want with you, no? And in the context of violence towards minors, for example, the situation that everybody was commenting in regard to Donald Trump, separating families and deporting, those are laws and practices that come from Bill Clinton time. And it has been happening for a long time. And it's precisely a legal practice that was based on this notion of the best interest of the child, of the system separating migrant children from their parents, because it's to protect them from the supposed risk they put their parents put them in by crossing the border. No, but this notion of the best interest that is quite useful for patriarchal institutional violence, also not only racist but also patriarchal institutional violence. I have seen it in the recent years in the context of Spain, also in the context of Peru, being used to commit terrible violence. For example, in the context of Spain, and mostly with migrant mothers, it is systematic that there is, if you denounce the father of your child for committing sexual abuse, it is systematic that they use the SAP, that is a alienation, the paternal alienation syndrome, this supposed syndrome in which supposedly the mother is so crazy and she hates so much the man and the male and the father that she's inventing the sexual abuse in order to alienate and separate the children from the father. So as they use this supposed syndrome straight away when you make a denounce, then there is no investigation carried out in regard to those who could be abusers, no? And we all know that 80% of the sexual abuse in regard to minors happen inside the house. It doesn't happen in the street, it happens inside the house. And that's just numbers and a reality. And then we know also that in the context of Spain, 70% of the denounces of sexual abuse towards minors are not being investigated, and that mothers are being separated from their children, because it's not only that the possible abuser is not investigated, it's also that the one who gets investigated is the mother. And that the solution that the system gives is that they need to separate the mother from the child in order for her not to put bad ideas in the mind of the child. And the child has to reshape his relationship with the father. So they send the children to live with a person that maybe is an abuser, no? And that's not, as I say, we're talking about, as I said, of 70% of the denounces not being investigated. And when it comes to migrant mothers denouncing Spanish fathers of sexual abuse, that we know it exists and it could happen, is directly, I have seen cases of mothers, Peruvian mothers actually, not seeing their children for 3-4 years because they dare to denounce that. But at the same time, the white feminists with a white left wing nowadays pass a law that if you have suspicions of your child being abused and you don't denounce, you can be separated from your child because you put in risk to your child. So in both situations, you are in risk. And then we have all the system of the social services in which migrant mothers approach, because mostly migrant single mothers approach because they don't have economical resources because of structural patriarchy and capitalism and colonialism and racism and all the situation. They approach to the social services that they pay with their taxes, and they have the right to approach those social services. And usually what happens is they open you a process of investigation that you are not able to take care of your child. And they use this concept of maltrato por negligencia. It's like you are committing a mistreatment because you are neglecting your child, which I think in Canada and in the States it also exists. But the notion of neglect means that many times you cannot accomplish the way of raising a child in a European culture and way of life, capitalistic way of life. So basically many families, for example, for not having money, for being evicted from your house, for not having papers. And this is not the interpretation of the social worker. This is a legal frame that you can read that it says clear that if the mother doesn't have papers, she is a risk factor, and that can be used legally. And I have done the exercise because they have like a, you can like try their system online, and you can match the, for example, factors that, as I said, doesn't have to do with sexual, physical, or psychological violence. And the outcome is an alert saying that this family should have a process open in order to investigate that if maybe there is a process, a situation of mistreatment for neglect, no? And that obviously opens a whole complex situation of a family. And then we're talking about that the centers for minors are privatized, so at the same time it's a business. And then obviously, like, you need another source for the industry of adoption of white people, you know, of white women that decided to have children after their 50s or some kind of stuff like that, because they want to travel the global south and go to Thailand, Peru, Bolivia, and everywhere until they are 40 something, and they want to have fun and drink and everything. And then they decide when they are 50 that they want to have children. And where do they go? To grab the children of racialized women, and then with all this narrative of charity, no? That they are like helping these children, when really I say, if you really love those children and those racialized children that are in centers and for adoption, one big responsibility because of that supposed love would be to investigate where do they come from. Because it's not only this system that we're having in the context of Europe, no, of a systematic withdrawal of children from their places. In Italy, where I'm now, the situation has been terrible, for example, with the Ecuadorian community. But it's a practice that has happened systematically, for example, in context of war in the global south. You know, in Peru, there has been many cases during the 80s and the time of the armed conflict where children were being abducted by these supposed charity foundations from poor women, no? Or in the context, for example, of Guatemala, the same, etc. No, there are many organizations of adopted children that are claiming for this type of practices, etc. No, and then, well, what happened to me was that I had my son was born in Spain. First, he was born not being recognized as Spanish, because they're like, even though you're born in the territory, you're not recognized as such. So he was confronted to the immigration law since he was born. And then because I end up having the situation that his father is an abuser, but he's an intelligent abuser, and he's European, and he used all this legal system, even though he was not taking care of the child we had in common, or like anything that had to do with money, taking care of him. But he ended up opening me a trial, a process, a legal process, in which I had to go through DNA, through investigation of where I was getting my money from, etc. And in parallel, one of my closest friends got her daughter taken away. And then I realized that it was not only me, and it was not only my best friend, it was all my migrant friends had processes, whether by the state or whether by European fathers of their children. And we had all of us, our maternities and the raising of our children judicialized, not by mistake, because there is a whole system that judicializes, that allows whether fathers to do it or whether the state to do it, to judicialize in order to control the way. And as Linda says, and I think it has to do a lot with the context in Canada, no? Linda Porner is my friend with whom I have been working in denouncing not only through art, but we are organized. We have a collective called Madrecitas, and we have been working with mothers that are going through this violence, etc. And as she says, no, this violence is created in order to also cut the channel of transmission of culture to our children, no? And is exactly what the policy was in the context of Canada, no? To have children removed forcibly from their and kidnapped from their communities and be like shaped, you know, having their language being forbidden, having their spirituality being forbidden, their way of lives, and having mostly the love of their family, you know, the level of violence and pain is like, I have, losing a son or a child is one of the biggest, I mean, like if your son dies, we all know it's one of the biggest pains, and it's recognized socially that it can be one of the biggest pains somebody can go through. But the torture that means to have your children being taken away, and the psychological torture that means to think that you can go through that situation is terrible. And it's something that is being used systematically in Chile, it's being used systematically in Argentina nowadays, in Spain, in Norway, in Italy, etc. No?
Maybe it's too much, and I think there are like some questions, but I think it will be a nice moment to show the image of Fernandito.
Yeah, I go fast.
No, because he's like the, how to say, like the antecedent. I don't know if that's a word in English, but the...
Yeah, because it's an historical antecedent of this type of torture, no? And violence, uh-huh. No? As disappearing bodies is a way of violence, political violence that has been used in history. Separating children from their families is also a way of exercising this violence. Well, this is a small series that is similar to the Rebellion of the Roots, but different also, about Fernandito Túpac Amaru, that was the son of Micaela Bastidas and Túpac Amaru, who carried out one of the biggest anti-colonial rebellion that has one of the biggest also repressions in the context of Peru before the, let's say, the Criollo or independence that happened afterwards. And after having his parents, Micaela and Túpac Amaru, being killed in front of a lot of people in order to kind of create, no, and a way of public punishment also, the Spanish, with this speech of paternalism, said, as Fernandito was so young, we are not going to kill him, but we are going to send him to be exiled in an African territory. That's what they said, no? In an African territory that they had in their possession at the moment, or invaded at the moment. But then in the process, when they were sending Fernandito to that context, they said maybe it's not a good idea because he has all the anti-colonial memory and that could be dangerous because he could make an alliance with people in Africa and then maybe make another uprising. So at the end, they end up deciding to send him to a prison in Spain. And then after many years of being detained, more than 10 years of being detained, he ended up having some kind of permission to go out and to have some kind of a public life, but for example, he couldn't work, so he was not legally allowed to work, so he ended up dying by depression and by poverty, but he ended up dying in Lavapiés, that is the biggest migrant community neighborhood in the context of Madrid, no? And for me, it was also always beautiful to think that the spirit of Fernandito Túpac Amaru, that was the youngest of this family and that was the only one that was not killed, and also is the only one that maybe we can find his body, because with the other ones were absolutely disappeared, that his spirit is in the neighborhood of Lavapiés, a neighborhood that is also known for having many of anti-racist organizations and having a strong anti-racist uprisings, no? So with this story, with this idea of the spirit of Fernandito being in Madrid and in Lavapiés, This is more like a plegary that I ask his spirit to give strength to the anti-colonial movement in the context of Spain and the anti-racist movement, to tear down the Columbus Monument and to use it to open the door of the immigrant detention center in Madrid in order to liberate our fellows who are there detained. And then also to bring justice to those families that have been separated nowadays from their kids, living that colonial violence through that separation. And I'm sorry, but I don't have the last one, but the last one shows the body of Fernandito Tupac Amaru going back to the territories of the Andes where it should be, no? Because at the moment, there is no exact information, but we think it is in the context of Madrid. Obviously, they know where the body is, no?
Thank you, Daniela. I'm just going to jump in because we have a comment and a question. I'll read the comment first. This comment comes from Sayonara Kunha. The system creates the problems and then sells the solution, is the comment to what you were discussing a little bit earlier. And her question is to Daniela. Your work is so powerful. I wonder if you face any type of aggression because of your art. If so, how do you deal with it?
Well, last year, because I'm going to take out the images, if it's okay. Last year, because I'm also active, let's say, politically, and I have been part of anti-racist organizations, and now we're working together with the mothers, etc. And so sometimes I had like invitations to like media, TV, which is a place also where we need to confront, no? Because it's a big space for racism where it's built, no? And because I was explaining this type of ideas that are not individual, nor are collective ideas that have been existing for 500 years in the Spanish TV, I end up not only receiving a lot of death threats and a lot of insults publicly, privately, to my email and all type of things, a thing that is common to any person that opposes colonialism or racism, because it's not a particular experience. Anybody that raises up their voice against that is going to receive violence, whether by white supremacists in the streets or the state. But then the risky situation that happened is that a group of extreme right that was strongly tied and was and police is part of it, were trying to open me a legal process. On one hand, in order to criminalize me because of my ideas, and in the context of Spain, that is quite common. There is a lot of people that are in jail because of their ideas. And the most dangerous thing that end up pushing me to take the decision of leaving Spain, and that's why I'm living in Peru for 1 year now, was because the main issue they were discussing was that me as a mother, I wasn't doing a good job in how I was raising my child. And they were putting even, for example, my political activities that I carry out with my son because I am single mother, or the artistic activities that I was giving talks and doing stuff like that. I mean, my participation in the Creative Time Summit was narrated by them as a type of violence towards my son because my son was in the stage with me, which could sound crazy to us. But then when you see the cases and how children are being removed from their families. I have seen a case of a family from Cameroon that because they gave him an oil that is common in Cameroon for the stomachache, the Spanish authorities accused him of a murder attempt, and they separated that child from their parents because they didn't share the way taking care of a child is understood in the context of Cameroon. And it's not only they give you a recommendation, they separate you from your child. And it was clear that these people were trying to open me a process, so I end up living in Spain, and that's why I'm living in, and for example, now I'm in Europe for work, etc., but I don't bring my child to Europe by any means. But it's, I think, as I said, it's common. Like if you think, for example, Elena Maleno, that is an anti-racist activist in Spain, like she has been like through a similar story 2 years ago. Like it's systematic. A lot of people live in like this type of repression, no?
Sorry to hear that, Daniela, but thank you for responding to that question. I'm wondering, Florencia, do you have any questions for Daniela? I have one question, but I'll let you go first if you have something that you'd like to.
No, Kanika, I think I already had my chance, and Daniela and I are in constant conversation, so please continue. And I also think it's a good moment for the public to make questions if they have them.
Yeah, of course, we welcome all questions from our audience. In the meanwhile, I'll ask my question. Daniela, I'm interested in, of course, you speak a lot about giving voice to, you know, minor histories, marginal stories. And I'm interested in the way you're introducing this into children's literature. If you could share share some insight into what made you choose that sort of path and how that's changed your practice. And I know there is a publication coming up, so we'd love to share it with our audiences as well.
Yeah, the Rebellion of the Roots is going to be a book soon, because I love doing painting, but also sometimes painting cannot be easily like distributed. So I'm making a book out of the paintings. But then I have made, maybe I can show you here just a sec. I have made other books, like for example, this one that is called Papa with P for Patriarchy is also hand painted. And it's a book that mostly approaches patriarchal violence through the legal system and also sexual abuse, et cetera, no? That many issues that are difficult to talk with in other contexts. Or for example, I made also the ABC of Racist Europe, or there is a monster under my bed, there is a story about institutional racism and a monster that really is the guy from the immigration office and the fear that it brings to many families. And all that started when I got pregnant. It was when I was pregnant, not only understand the violence and what it means, all these type of policies, but also I think you find much more urgent to create tools in order to talk about this. And if you think, for example, of groups such as the Radical Brownies that I admire a lot in the context of the state, no, there are this type of girls, scouts of racialized girls that are organized. The ones who have been pushing there are their own mothers. It's not the state, it's not the school or something else. It's their own mothers that are worried to create the tools in order for their children to also to have a way of also discussing and sharing. And once, as also to the Radical Brownies, they have questioned them, if talking about racism is accordance to their age, because, and they always answer like, we see that violence, even if you are 3, 4, 5 year old in your neighborhood, how you're not going to be able to discuss about it, no? And that when I was presenting the ABC of Racist Europe in Madrid, a Spanish person made that question, no? That if that book was good for children and et cetera, like questioning this type of literature for children. But then there was a Peruvian girl actually that answered him like, the first time I lived a super violent racist situation was when I was 4. So I guess since you are 4, it's needed to have that, no? Because then these people are okay with you or your child living the violence in regard to that, but they are not okay when you discuss about it, no? And it's always the same answer, like every time we want to have a discussion about racism, racist symbols, incarceration, deportation, they say, I know you're too violent to talk about this, but then they live in complete peace with the system that is created that violence towards communities, no? So yeah, since that moment, and then also because in, but that from before, in, I always see art as a pedagogical tool, no? I'm always interested in not only like creating like visual experience with creativity, etc., but also creating memory, for example, through those visual narratives. That's why it's important to put names, to put dates, no? Because in the book schools, many times you're not going to find that memory in like official literature for children. You're not going to find that memory. And it's the memory of many children. I mean, many children like my son that are was born in Spain is part of their experience. The situation of being born, for example, in a context that doesn't recognize him as national. It's not that we want to be Spanish, but it's the only way we have in order to do not be deported, no? But that's a specific experience of growing up that is not being recognized. And I think it's important to create also not only like the tools in order to talk about that, but then also the tools in order to create a memory that has been happening in these communities, no? There is a party here, I just realized. I hope that the noise is not too loud.
No, that's perfectly fine. Thank you, Daniela. I think at this point we don't have more questions, but I would like to thank the both of you for joining us. I know, Daniela, it is late where you are. But we really feel very honored to have you both as part of this discussion. Thank you to our audience who participated today, and just for our audience members who are still here, there will be a recording that we will post shortly on our website. So do check back in, and thank you.
Thank you, Kanika. And thanks, Florencia.
Thank you, Daniela. Yeah. And seguimos.
Seguimos.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ciao.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.